course, issues that are relevant to our surroundings. So before I begin, I do want to thank Dr. Irene Vasquez, who's the director of Chicano Studies here at Cal State University of Davis Hills, and Dr. Warren Ashton, the executive producer of DH Television Courses, for making this opportunity possible. I am honored to host this particular program, and I truly appreciate their support. And most importantly, I have a fantastic crew, and I'm excited to begin this journey into understanding something about mestizaje, the mixing of populations of European, African, and Native American descent to create peoples like us, mestizos. So, in this course, today we have an exciting program that's scheduled. And we are going to first try to understand something about what it means to be Chicano and understand something about Chicano studies. And we're going to try to recognize some major theoretic concepts that are going to be used throughout the course. And the way we're going to do this is try to appreciate something about ourselves here as citizens of the United States, and understanding something about what Chicano is and what we are all about. We're going to identify some major periods of Chicano history and become familiar with the periods that this course will cover. We're going to try and most importantly appreciate the role of music in the Chicano identity. And we have a special guest today, Marcos Loya, who is a professional musician, and he will help us understand and appreciate something about Chicano music. So I want to thank all of you, Gabrielles and Joshuas and Christophers, for enrolling in the course. And I want to thank all of you on Cableland, your AJs, and Davis, Devers, and Noes for tuning in. Hopefully we'll have a good journey. But first, of course, let me share a little bit about myself as we begin this journey, so that you recognize why it is that I'm up here. My name is Mike Fryer, and I was born and raised in El Paso, Texas. I come from the border. I come from many directions racially. I come from many directions culturally. And my experiences along the border influenced me to get involved in an appreciation of my history, an appreciation of my cultural background, and my racial heritage. I have a very strong teaching background, and I have considerable experience teaching with diverse learning communities in multicultural settings. I was blessed, having been born along the border, to appreciate something about border constructs, about us versus them. And it is within this particular experience that it led me to appreciate something about my native past, my European past, and now understanding a little bit more about African and Asian heritage in my history. My research interests, when I went to higher education, I naturally was inclined towards history, and my research interest encompassed the history of indigenous and Mexican people in the United States, Southwest and Northern Mexico, and their historical interrelations. So I majored in history when I was at Stanford University, and I went to study under some pretty impressive historians at UCLA that trained me and helped me appreciate something about U.S. history, Chicano history, and Native American history. And these are three areas that I am very well rehearsed in. And it is my experiences with these particular, with this understanding of the past that I come to try to share something about this particular course in Chicano history. It is about my experiences, it is about my personal reflections going and traveling throughout the border of the United States and Mexico, trying to appreciate something about my rich heritage. Just to share with you, Fraga, that's only one of my many directions, but primarily from my dad's side and my grandfather. Fraga is Spanish, Italian, and Portuguese. And it is a name that's used to identify a particular species of berry. In Italy, it's strawberry, and in Spain, it's the raspberry, and in Portugal, it's the BlackBerry. So that's one aspect of Fraga Fragoso, Fraga Fruit, Fraga Magno. There's also Frage, which is German and Hebrew, and it means question. Now, it's not that I'm a questionable fruit, but I am a very nice guy. And Fraga has been always a partner, but there's also Morales, and there is also Camarena and La Paz. And these names have rich indigenous heritage. I have ancestors from Chihuahua and Durango, is the northern states of Mexico. And a long time ago, when Native peoples were moving around the United States, U.S. policy eliminated populations. Native peoples were constantly in movement trying to find communities that would accept them. And so what happened is certain communities, I'm tempted to go and point out this map to share with you where my relatives were from in this region and how Native communities went into this region, my heritage. And they came into this region and intermingled with communities that were already part of Durango and Chihuahua, and eventually will find their way up to the border. And so this is part of my Native heritage. My Native heritage stems from being Shawnee and Blackfoot. Blackfoot from Idaho region came down south, and likewise from Ohio region, Kickapoo and Shawnee. And so everybody came together in Chihuahua and in Durango and intermingled with the Spanish communities or Mexican communities that were coming from the south. Eventually, my mom and my dad were born in El Paso, and then they had me. And this rich heritage is what led me into history. This rich heritage is what led me specifically to understand something about myself and appreciate something about my heritage, the mixtures. And this is why we have courses like this to kind of study. Now, living in America, living in the United States, one of the things that's most important is that growing up in this educational system is that we have to appreciate that most Americans are prejudiced. We learn the values of dominant society, and the dominant society, of course, has been governed by particular institutions that have been addressing certain questions of who is part of American society and who isn't. So we've always grown up in the educational system with the prejudice. I'll share with you at the outset, when we understand something about our prejudices, we can thank Thomas Jefferson, especially in this country, for coining a phrase, mercies and savages. This phrase is in the Declaration of Independence. In the Declaration of Independence, Native peoples were considered savages, whose lone rule of warfare was the undisputed destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. And so, when we talk about, as Americans, about Native peoples, we really don't understand much about Native peoples. That's why we have such notions as, some kind of war hoop, or, as we see in sports a lot, especially from coming out of Florida State University. We have these prejudices that we have about Native peoples. Well, likewise, me growing up along the border, I grew up with a prejudice. One of my important prejudices that I grew up with was canned green beans. I do not like canned green beans. Canned green beans, I just never appreciated them. They somehow just did not go down with good taste. Canned green beans, they're slimy, they're green, they're alien beans. I just grew up in prejudice, and in this prejudice, I developed a means of action by which to carry out my prejudice. I created a stereotype about these canned green beans. These canned green beans, if you can take a look at them, they are slimy, they're green, they're alien. You can see how waxy they are. There we go. How waxy they are. I just could not digest them. I just developed an attitude that I couldn't accept them. And as a result, let me actions was to create that stereotype, and there was a social result of my actions. I avoided them. I have always avoided the green beans. Now, green, I like white navy beans. White navy beans, and they're delicious. They're really nutritious beans. They're healthy for the tacos. I learned to appreciate white navy beans. I also learned to appreciate black beans. Black beans are delicious. They come from Guatemala. They help me appreciate something about my Guatemalan past. And I appreciate white black beans. And then, of course, there's the famous red kidney beans. Now, who doesn't appreciate salads without red kidney beans? Red kidney beans are so nutritious. And I really like those beans. And then, of course, there are the yellow beans. The yellow beans are the garbanzo beans. The garbanzo beans, they go great in salads. They're also good with other side dishes. And then you mix them with fruits. I like them too. So garbanzo beans are good. And then who, of course, when you combine all of these beans together, you're going to get some brown beans. These brown beans, these are the best beans ever. The brown beans, because everybody who eats them can get down and get brown. These are good beans. So when we appreciate all of these beans together, they are fantastic, don't you think? I really appreciate these beans. But canned green beans, they just don't seem to go. The greens go. So I don't like the canned green beans. I like all the other beans, but these canned green beans. So one of the things that I have introduced to you is the concept known as prejudice. And in this concept, I shared with you that when, because I am prejudiced for canned green beans or against canned green beans, I developed a means of action by which to label these canned green beans and created a stereotype. And the stereotype, I call them green alien beans. And through this stereotype, I then it resulted socially that I was disliked for affording these beans. Now, one of the reasons why I'm introducing you to my prejudices is because we are going to be talking about these concepts in this course. Concepts from this course are going to be related to prejudices that everyone has to deal with and we have to deal with. I have prejudices against these beans. Now, this is my individual choice, is to be prejudiced against canned green beans. But what if I wanted to influence society and get everybody to not like canned green beans? What if I opened up a restaurant? And if I opened up a restaurant, I wanted to discriminate against these beans. Let's say I wanted to just serve all of these highly nutritious, delicious beans, and I didn't want to serve these beans. So, my means of action here is my concept. I want to discriminate against these beans. I'm already prejudiced against them, but now I don't want them to be served in the restaurant that I open up. So, what if I were to put up a sign and say, what if I were to put up a sign and say that these canned green beans are not allowed with these beans? I would, in order to make this feasible, is I would have to have the law behind me. I would make it legal. The action would be to make it legal. And by me going to my city council representative, I try to pass a law, local law, to say that I want to serve these beans, but I'm not going to serve these beans, and I want to put a sign up at my restaurant that says, please, no canned green beans allowed. No dogs, no canned green beans allowed. So I have the law behind me. And by doing that, by having the law behind me, then I create a population of green beans that would be disadvantaged. All the other beans would have, it would be in a favorable position because they'd be served in the restaurant. The canned green beans wouldn't be able to. The canned green beans are very important. Now, there is a question that a student asked about what Chicano actually means, and I'm going to share with you, please, if you could just be patient, because I'm going to get to that, even though perhaps I'm confusing you with my prejudice against canned green beans. But there is a purpose here for me to share with you the importance of the concepts that I'm going to be introducing in this class. The social result of me discriminating against these canned green beans is that now canned green beans are at a disadvantage. They're at a disadvantage position. So when we take a look at their disadvantaged position, pan green beans aren't going to be as appreciated in society as much as these other valuable beans. Now, the canned green beans, if they wanted to improve their taste, obviously they have to go to school to try to educate themselves so that they can be more flavorable, however you want. So, one of the things about having access to education is improving your status. Well, canned green beans would not be able to improve their status, so they would suffer what would be known as educational deprivation. They would be denied access to education, as these other beans were attempting to improve their flavors. Canned green beans would. The other thing is, of course, if canned green beans wanted to survive with regards to their experiences in society, they wanted to improve their lot in the economy, that means they want to find a good job. And one of the things that would be most important for them is that they get a good paying job. However, they would be at a disadvantage simply because their canned green beans would be discriminated against them, so they would not get a similar wage as these other beans. So they would experience what would be known as economic marginality. The dual wage system would prevent them from earning the same amount of money as these full beans, these delicious beans. Most importantly, if the community of canned green beans wanted to address the problems that they face in terms of being discriminated against, they try to get access to the political system. But because they wouldn't have the rights that other beings have because of their discriminatory status, they would not be allowed to participate politically, so they would experience what is known as political disenfranchisement. So when you couple educational deprivation, when you couple it with political disenfranchisement, when you incorporate it with economic marginality, and then on top of that, the discrimination, you find that the community experiences acute disillusionment. And one of the most important things about this is, of course, that disillusionment is going to rob life of its meaning. So a new system of explanation and rationale for action has to be created self-consciously by these beings. But then on top of that, what's going to happen is that these beings aren't going to be allowed the opportunity to live with these other beings. These beings just don't want them, so they're going to experience segregation. Experience segregation. Well, the means of management which to carry out that segregation and to keep and prevent these beings from interacting with this community of other well flavored beings, that experience is going to be legal. It's going to be made legal. And the means of action to make that legal is again passing laws that would prevent these types of beings from living with the rich. Flavorful beans. So the social result is that you have isolated a population. And what happens in this particular experience is when people are responding to the communities, all you need is a defining moment and event by which to stir public opinion to accept and rationalize segregation, to accept and rationalize the discrimination. All you need is a defining moment by which to go to the next step. And the next step is, of course, to eliminate this population, to get them out of the way. Now, many times these beings, I don't know of any beings that don't want to be accepted by other beings. And many times these beings will try to do whatever they can to be part of this community. I remember when my mother tried to get me to eat my green beans, she would kind of smother them in chorizo, or maybe put them in eggs. But for me, I could always tell that these beans, they made it in there, they just weren't part of it. I just had a prejudice against them. I didn't like the fact that they would try to be with these green beans. So what I'm trying to share with you here in terms of these concepts, I was just playing around here with these beans, and I was playing around with the term beings because Sister Chavez always said that we are all human beings. We are all part of this process, this experience together as humans in our struggles. And one of the reasons why I introduced this concept in this way is to help us appreciate something about prejudices. Now, for me, I just don't like canned green beans. I don't care how they're prepared. That's my personal prejudice. So when we take a look at all of these concepts as a whole, when we understand prejudice, the stereotype, the avoidance, when we understand discrimination, the use of facts that make it illegal, and then the disadvantage, create a disadvantaged population, when we take a look at segregation, the idea of making segregation legal, and then it being isolated, if you put that one slide up that just shares all the concepts together, yes. We can understand something about the process that this course is going to be involved in with regards to appreciating a population that has to deal with racism. This is known in sociology as the racialization process. When we take a look at racism, racism is an instrument of power used by those in power to perpetuate their power. And one of the things about racism, as I was going through trying to share with you about my prejudice towards beings, even though all beings are supposed to be equal, racism ascribes certain moral, intellectual, and genetic qualities to very real differences in skin color and hair type and body features. So racism, in one sense, becomes a controlling ideology. The set of ideas is related to concepts of inferiority, of superiority, and they become ingrained as natural. So, racism and sexism can be considered similar in this way. So, as we take a look at these concepts that I introduced you to, and probably we can get a full-blown picture so that everyone can appreciate it. You know, there's a concept in action and a result. And when we take a look at all of these things, we can understand and appreciate something about hatred. Because all we need is that defining moment, an event to create a hysteria and a fear of the other. One of the reasons why I introduced this is because I do come from the border. I have an experience of what borders do in terms of creating fear and separating us from the other. Because ultimately, all we need in that defining moment, an event to create hysteria, is an event that tells us how to hate. Now, how do people come about hating a population? How do we understand something about speech? I know of no child that is born racist. I know of no child that is born sexist. So when we take a look at societies attempting to deal with people's experiences with each other, we need to come to appreciate how Professor Tyler says that we are all human beings. And even though the greens go, my idea of my concept of appreciating beings, nonetheless, all beings have to be appreciated. As Sister Sarah says, we are all human beings, all beings have to be appreciated, which gets me to the notion of civil rights. In the 1960s, there was this great movement to make sure that the government was not involved in legalized discrimination, legalized in segregation, because the ultimate step is towards the elimination of the population. So the civil rights movement is important here for us to appreciate, and the concepts that I'm introducing you to, because the civil rights movement addressed the issues of what results from discrimination, what results from segregation. That disadvantaged population has to deal with social racial discrimination, educational deprivation, political disfranchisement, and economic marginality. So the civil rights movement in the 1960s was a movement primarily of African Americans simply because they were most visible simply because they were black. But it was also a movement of women, a movement of Chicanos, of Mexicans living in the southwest United States. It was a movement of American Indians. It was a women's movement, and eventually, girls of alternative expressions known as gays. All of these people got together to try to influence Congress to get out of the business of discrimination, to get out of the business of segregation. Now, unfortunately, Everybody has their prejudices. I have my prejudices. I don't like canned green beans. But that doesn't mean that I should not influence society by saying that you should serve them in restaurants. So let's take a look at a clip, a phone clip, of a great speech. We just honored this man. We are involved right now in African American History Month, we call it Black History Month, so that we can educate ourselves about disadvantaged populations, the disadvantaged populations that attempted to do, and are still attempting to do, to fight institutionalized racism. Let's take a look at a film clip of a famous speech by Martin Luther King.
But one day, this nation will rise up and live up the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day, down in Alabama with its vicious racism, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and notification, one day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls and sisters and brothers. I have a dream for me.
Okay, so we are free at last. I don't know if it's free at last. There are still some problems with regards to ensuring civil rights, but Graham, you just asked the question about what does Chicana actually mean. Hopefully, as you keep watching, the answer is going to come to you, because now what we need to appreciate about what Martin Luther King was addressing in terms of the discrimination and what this nation had to do to kind of get out of the legal basis of discriminating. So there are many different dimensions to the civil rights movement, and one of the most important movements here in the Southwest is the Chicano movement. So what I want to do is follow through on the Chicano movement by appreciating the generation that had to live the discrimination, the segregation, the isolation, and they had to face elimination. The repatriation movement of the 1930s, we're going to take a peek at the first mass repatriation, the first deportation, mass deportation of Mexicans in the United States. That happened in the 1930s. Most people don't really understand or appreciate what happened to them. But what I want to do is I want to share a film clip of a community in Arizona, a mining community in Houston, where they see Arizona. And this mining community had to face deportation in the 1930s. And so what I want to share with you is that when you face discrimination and when you face segregation, it works on you. Let's listen to Edward Montoya and this community from a film clip of a documentary called Los Mineros. Let's watch this and see it. It's experience this community's expressions as a result of facing discrimination.
Standing around the post office with one of my animals. We're coming by here now. This guy by name of Pete Reddy was a proud spider rustler. He was driving an ugly knife, Dodge. He slammed the faces of red and blue spirit. Say, you goddamn dirty Mexican next time, Brian. Some of this I'm gonna kick your ass up and down. The railroad tracks. Many reasons. For years and years and years. For the next decade, the Mineros fascinated your powers. But the land will be the same way. But the worst was yet to come.
Started out perhaps as a very mannerly order, turned out to be a total helter-skelter way of saying Mexicans back home. Mexicans were rounded up illegally. Mexicans were just shipped back. Many of these Mexicans were Americans. They were born in the United States. They were naturalized legally.
Because they hate it hurts. It hurts me.
Generation is so instrumental in creating what eventually will become the Chicano movement in the 1960s. It's that World War II generation that first faced repatriation. They were not wanted in the United States. And then they go and now they're recruited to go and fight for the United States. And when they come back, they experience the same four-part process, which leads to the Chicano movement. So hopefully, again, Graham, you'll understand what Chicano means, and Jessica and Verla, you can recognize something about the cycles of change that are occurring in every generation, because every generation has to face what it means to be Chicano. Now, there is this one film clip that I wanted to share with you about a Texan who was a farm worker that went back and forth from Texas to Indianapolis, working the sugar beet farms, working the farms, and he comes to Lubbock and experiences racism. Let's go back to that film.
And there was a famine truck, and the kid was crying, but was hungry. So I stopped at the restaurant, and I went in there, yes, this for a couple of hamburgers. And then the waiter came to me and said, what do you want? I just want a couple of hamburgers for a couple of kids that are crying. Want something to eat? And she said, well, let me talk to them. I don't know if I can, but let me talk to my boss. So he went back. Big man came to the back door. He said, what the hell you want? If I just put up the symbol. Can you read? Yes. Can you see that sign? He said, to see, all right. What did he say? He said, no Mexican land. Why don't you get out? Yeah, I just want to have a symbol, sir. I said, get out and stay out. And he just pushed me through the screen door. Oh, boy, that made me feel terrible. I was about ready to drive the truck and then run over the whole restaurant.
All right, so one Felix was super inside you, and the other I wanted to run over the restaurant. Again, I can't emphasize enough how the Chicano movement came about. It just didn't all of a sudden explode because of people's final frustration with discrimination, segregation. But it was a long, drawn-out process of previous generations experiencing this, and it was that World War II generation, that influenced the beginnings of movements for change, especially in the 1950s, as people decided segregation is enough, discrimination is enough. And so the idea was to challenge Congress to change the laws. And that's how we get the Chicano movement. So what it means really to be Chicano is to become aware of your history and recognize the four-part process of struggles for change, of making sure that you confront the social and racial discrimination, that we're all human beings, we are all equal, that we get rid of dual wage structures and recognize that everyone has a right to a just wage, that we address economic marginality, and that most importantly, that everyone have access to education, because through access to education, that is how you improve yourself. And the key here is making sure that you have access to the political process, that your politicians become responsive to your needs. This is a continuing process. So to be Chicano, is to be part of that. And that's why we have Chicano Studies. That's why we have this particular course, Chicano Studies 100. The emphasis is going to be on recognizing that historical past, trying to appreciate that our generational expressions. We're going to go and appreciate what it means when the Europeans and the Africans came and they were able to enslave peoples to create peoples like us, mestizos, mixed-blooded populations. And Chicano Studies 100 focuses on what is known as the Americas, bringing people together. So we're going to be taking a look at it. We're not necessarily going to be taking a look at the Chicano movement. That's what Chicano Studies 200 is all about. But the idea here is that we continuously get involved and interact with that past. That past is constantly with us in the present. And Gerda, the reason why everyone is not equal is simply because everyone still has to deal with those prejudices. And it's most importantly, we have to be involved in the political process to make sure that the laws do not discriminate, the laws do not segregate populations. Prejudices are there. Everybody has their prejudices. The whole idea is to get beyond that. Now, one of the ways that we can get beyond our prejudices is, of course, to use music is the international language that brings all human beings together, and every movement has its music. And I am honored to have a special guest come with us today to journey with us on Chicano studies, Chicano studies, try to appreciate and help us understand something about what Chicano music is all about. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at some films of our guest. His name is Marcos Lola. Marcos Lola is a professional musician here in Los Angeles. And we're going to just kind of take a look at while we set up here to bring in our guest, take a look at some footage of Marcos Lola and realize how important our guest is.
You are watching the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Yes, my name is Carlos Vieira. I'm a transfer student from Harvard College. I attended a Bay High School moment in California, and I'm currently a BA major over at California State University of Dominguez Hills. I chose a program in Brazil offerings, but didn't go in and moved in that major. I'm also a minor in Spanish, and I love the atmosphere, the faculty, all the professors have been great. Everything has been really helpful. This is really like a home.
I took a lot of the distance learning classes recently for convenience. I'm excited to get home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or if it didn't work out that way, David, watch it on my own. major. Well, I took the distance learning course because it's, I'm able to watch videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that if you watch it at home or you're at the media center. And I would recommend this to a friend. I came here from El Centro, California. My major is audio recording, and what brought me here to Community Skills is their digital media arts program. I learned that many students that graduate from the program have gone on to receive awards and recognition. And I'm really happy with the staff and the program in general, and I'm glad to be a part of it.
Workshops, we did folk tales for local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as a entertainment. Doing theater to help make our lives better is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, after we'll do a play reading about play about some getting into American culture and our Asian communities, and that makes
Thank you.
Studies. This is a course that looks at the Mexican Indian, African, and European peoples who created a major new world mestizo cultures that influence a significant portion of the Western Hemisphere today. I am honored to have a guest with me, Marcos Loya. Marcos Loya is an accomplished musician, a composer. He is the master of acoustic guitar. His debut CD, Love is the Reason, garnered an Independent Contemporary Jazz Album of the Year nomination. His film music is featured in the director Robert Rodriguez's Once Upon a Time in Mexico, as well as the cover Water Dance, A Million to One, Old Gringo, Vibes, Stand and Deliver, He's Born in East LA, A Hope Me, Kiss Me, Thrill Me, and of course, that's what he's going to do with us today. With Madonna, he recorded our love song when he died, and he appeared in the video, and hopefully it will give encouragement, and maybe I can have a crew go ahead and set up that video so that we can kind of appreciate his romance with Madonna, I guess, I don't know. But I'd like to introduce you to Marcos Loya. Welcome, Marcos. I would like for you to share with our special audience. We have students, and we have a cable television. I'd like for you to share with us why you consider yourself a Chicano and why you think Chicano studies is important for us.
Well, it sounds like I consider myself a Chicano. Of course, I'm a Mexican American that is, I was born here, and so my parents for that matter. But basically, American identity, many of us know has been overlooked and forgotten, you might say, in a lot of different ways. You know, we don't really get considered. So, the reasons of calling myself Chicano really, is deeply rooted in being seen as Chicano. Studies American. I mean, I'm an American. I was born in Southeast LA, the city of Powers, that's where I was born. And so, my reality, although, it's not mainstream GQ, commercial reality, my reality is, it's different. I'm an American, but I hold very strongly my primal instincts, which are based in passion, I would say, this relates directly to what you say. There's definitely spice in my life, not just in my food, but in terms of calling myself Chicano, as many artists do, musicians as well as graphic artists, what we're doing is basically we're identifying ourselves not, so much so that we get treated different, or to be treated equal, but so that we just exist. We exist. We are legitimate, these are things that are in our culture, but we have some really deep thinkers as well, and some visionaries, and some people that, that really are pushing out there, and usually some great games, and we have some really Chicano artists right now. So, this is the essence of the Chicano. This is not racism, no, this has nothing to do with, it has to do with just people are saying, you know, it's the biggest thing, and it's not that, we're better or the majority of people, something like that, necessarily, you know. It's just that for so long we've been in this limbo state, you know. It's like we, you know, every year are starting to market towards us, you know, commercials and it, you know, you gotta fight the adverse.
Sure, your music, what you're involved with. I know the students here today, so it's blessed to have you. Can you just share a little bit about what you do here?
So I've been teaching classes in basically music history, Chicago music history specifically. Part of it is Chicago, and some of it is, Mexican, and some of it is Latin American, whatever, but basically, we're talking about these different regions of Mexico, as well as different parts of Latin America that have sent their music this way, and it's come here and selected in the United States, and it's been done there, and that's what I've been teaching mostly. And then, of course, I have what we call the Minnesota's Urban Ensemble, and that's what I've been doing this semester. I mean, I've been doing it, Dr. Ross is from Chicago Studies, and Dr. Crabtree from the Music Department for helping me get this thing off the ground. And basically, we call it the Minnesota's Urban Ensemble, basically because, it's not trying to get a Chicago black-brown thing going on, but basically it's music of the people. I'm teaching about these students basically how to play it, and a lot of pieces is their music where each day they haven't gravitated to the area of American nice, something they tend to have to go towards, rap and whatever, and so all of a sudden I'm teaching them something that's part of their culture, part of the earth, it's music of the soul as opposed to the body.
Right, which leads us to, again, understanding something about Chicano. Something students really want to appreciate in this class. What is Chicano? I think what's important, of course, is understanding about the four-part struggle for change, trying to a community that's trying to address past practices of discrimination and segregation, and trying to be recognized as a legitimate community within this larger United States framework. So Chicano is very important as a process of change that we encounter in Mexico and the United States. But music has a lot to do with our existence.
About Chicano music, we talk about a broad term. What is Chicano music? What is it, Chicano music? Chicano's playing all types of music that's based in traditional forms, and some, of course, pop stuff has to be done. That's pretty, wide term there, very broad term. But basically, the way that I look at it is coming from that place, that private place, the place where art is born, And so, as we get our feet on the ground, you use a big word term there, it's about community, the sense of community. So when I say getting our feet on the ground, I'm talking about us, uniting us, seeing that no matter how American you are, or how Mexican national you are, or whatever, it's more about a frame of mind, it's close to ethnicity. How long have you lived here? It's just kind of a way of thinking, in a sense. As soon as we can, unite and see that we are more alike than we are different, and to be able to, someone who doesn't speak good Spanish, oftentimes you make fun of the Spanish speakers, and so you then want to Spanish speaker fun of yourself, in an American circle, and you've got an accent, and this stuff down. unite as a community because, you know, this is where the power lies, is, you know, my concept is, you know, you're so strong, you know, you educate yourself, then you share it with your family, you know, and then your community, and then humanity, and then the achievements. That's part of the most founding of how
I see you guys have just really different genres. Just give me a little bit of maybe if you could do a song, perhaps. Well, you know, a song that helps me really like that.
Well, yeah, I'm going to play Brown and Children's. Brown and Children's is a song that came out of the movie Mandela, the Great Strike. So, Sister Cubs, Delano, you know, is a song that I learned from Daniel Valdez. You know, the brother of Julius Valdez. I was working with him in the Alpha Casino. This song basically is about us. Let's hear it. Newspaper, you know, back in the day, they would document We're talking about a song that documents a period of time or a specific event or both. The corrido is oftentimes the voice of the people, documenting, and sometimes publishing as a story or whatever, but for the most part, it's not an art form. It's both documenting as well as it's expressing the passion. I mean, a lot of the songs are, built in passion, they climax with some sort of passion, some death, whatever. But the gorilla is surely used up on Sister Chavez. So, Sister Chavez is right for us. Sister Chavez, I had the pleasure of meeting her more than 3 times, and I was there actually up there in Atlanta when we both passed the second time. It was actually the fastest thing to miss in life, but my plan is that song with Gorilla Sister Chavez, which is directly from that period of time. Again, the movimiento of music, and it's written by Asunia, who was one of the musicians who worked in the early days with the dance of the casino, wrote the song, and was part of the Cisipode album, which was Carlos Lobos, which was, like in the 70s.
Before you get any of your shares, you were sharing with me about how you consider Sister Chavez.
Well, Sister Chavez, he was,
I've said to you that Martin Luther King,
he was definitely our companion, our Martin Luther King. He was the same, he was bigger, he was bigger than words. And I remember hearing a story about Robert Kennedy's wife, Robert Kennedy was saying he supported the farm workers, but at one point, Ethel Kennedy, right, she was up there, this is so much longer than this, and said, but she was there, supporting Sister Chavez. So there was an interviewer from the major team or whatever, and she was being interviewed, and he tried to relate Bobby Kennedy, and Sister Chavez, she stopped and talked to him.
Fresco, Absolutely, yeah, well, she does, she likes,
We only have so much time in our life for you to share us. What song do you think is important to us to appreciate for us to appreciate?
Well, I think a song was written by Diane Moses. I guess it's a song that's called Primavera. And Primavera was written by part of what I believe the song is about. It's about new beginnings. It's about perseverance. It's about hope. It's about faith. It's about beauty. And it's casting in the eyes of a juvenile in the hearts.
So I want to thank you very much for joining us for the song that is through the credits. Just thank you for joining us in this class. Bye, Sucker and Gable. Thank you, Michael Spoiler. I appreciate it.
Now the weight of winter's on. Once again we see the sun. And the birds come out to sing, tell the world she's home again. Primavera, Primavera. Her beauty makes men stop and stare. Days your love is so rare. Fills men with tranquility. Love for all humanity. Primavera, Primavera.